And welcome back, our dear viewers. As we promised at the beginning of the show, we are going to talk about the World Heritage Day. What's the World Heritage Day? Why it was chosen at this particular timing? And what heritage do we have here in Egypt? To shed more light on that topic, we are very much delighted to have in the studio Dr. Mohamed Nabil, the Egyptologist and author in Egyptology. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning to you, Dr. Nabil. Now, let's start with the choosing the 18th of April to be the World Heritage Day, and you, if you can explain to us more, yes. What about this particular day?
So it goes back to 1982, actually, when the International Council of Monuments and Sites, it chose that day to be the International Day for Monuments and Sites. Mm. But now we call it the World Heritage Day. Later on, it was agreed by the UNESCO in 1983, mm. To be the International Day for Monuments and Sites. So basically, it goes back to 1982 mm. and later on agreed by the UNESCO in 1983. There was a symposium in Tunisia dealing with the monuments protection in 1982. So that's why they said that why don't we have such a day to protect the monuments of the humanity or the monuments of the humankind mm. All over the world. Mm. But actually, the idea behind protecting the monuments goes back to the 50s, when the UNESCO started to protect our monuments in Abu Simbel. Mm. Because maybe you know that well,
yes,
once we started to build the high dam, there was a big problem that we had to move the Abu Simbel temples. So that's why the UNESCO was so much concerned with the protection of mm. The monuments and the human heritage. Mm.
Dr. Nabil, of course this is true, and many steps are taken to protect the monuments and heritage. But unfortunately yet, we are seeing a lot of negligence regarding the issue of many monuments and artifacts. Many artifacts from the Egyptian heritage are smuggled outside of the country and on display, and others are sold in different auctions. So what are the measures that should be taken, and what is the legality concerning these measures in order to get back our stolen heritage?
Of course, this is a very important question, and all of us are suffering because we have all our monuments or some of our monuments abroad. But actually, this is the cheapest way of advertising, because there is something very important mm. right here, that they don't say that these monuments belong to France, belong to England. They also say that this monument or this piece of monument goes back to Egypt. So this is a way of advertising. But actually, we are trying our best, and the Ministry of Antiquities mm. trying its best to bring the monuments back. Mm. But it depends on the constitution or the law, mm. because during the time of Muhammad Ali Pasha, for example, mm. he used to offer our monuments to the foreign countries. So we cannot ask to bring them back.
Mm. Because it was presented as a gift,
exactly. Mm. So we cannot.
So we have no rights to
get. We don't have rights to, and mm. even sometimes the obelisk and the Concorde, actually in France, and in return, or actually we got to the clock obelisk in the citadel, and in return we gave them the obelisk during the time of Muhammad yes. Ali Pasha. So we cannot return it back. But actually we can return the other monuments which were stolen and robbed during the ancient times and even nowadays.
But
actually we need to understand mm. something about our heritage.
Yeah. Mm.
But here I have a question for you. Why do people come to visit Egypt? Why we have tourism? Why? Mm. To see what?
Because people need to understand more about the history.
The history. They come here to see the civilization. So the civilization or the ancient Egyptian civilization is our heritage.
The problem is that we as Egyptians don't even appreciate this. And I don't think that we have enough awareness when it comes to the importance of our heritage.
That's why we have the International Day of Monuments and Sites.
But because how much we are aware, we as Egyptians, about the World Heritage Day and about how to protect our heritage, how to respect our culture and our monuments and our heritage, which is not the case, because even if many people are visiting the pyramids or any of these beautiful sites, we see a very negative attitude concerning dealing with these artifacts or these monuments. And how they can write, how they can throw garbage or whatever. We do not respect our heritage. Is it a lack of sense of belonging or a lack of understanding the importance of these heritage sites or what exactly?
This is true, but actually we need to define heritage, because heritage is not only monuments.
Yeah.
The heritage, that it's everything that we inherit from our parents and from our ancestors. So if you go to Luxor and Aswan and you can see them wearing the costumes and the dresses, the costumes and the dresses are heritage.
Indeed.
The food, heritage.
The music.
Songs, music, folkloric dance.
But do we still have a sense of belonging to this?
Yes, but we need to differentiate between two things, that we have tangible heritage and intangible heritage.
Indeed.
The tangible heritage is the civilization, the monuments, the sites. If you go to see the pyramids, to see Luxor and Aswan and all these places, the intangible heritage, that the dresses, costumes, festivals and everything.
Mm.
But the problem that we don't have the awareness, as you said, we need to teach our students at schools and in universities to understand.
Yes.
It comes from schools.
It comes from schools.
We need to have a certain subject about heritage, the Egyptian heritage, to let them feel our history. We need to increase the field trips to the sites, and we need to learn or to teach them how to respect the monuments.
You know what, Dr. Nabil, my cousins live in Paris, in France, and they came last year, and they have their school books, because part of their curriculum was about Egyptology, and they study Egyptology in schools, while my children here in Egypt, they don't.
Yes.
I mean, that was really strange, because they came, they have their books, they know every single details about the temples, about Luxor and Aswan, about the pyramids. They have a lot of information, more than our Egyptian kids do. This is very unfortunate. It's not only about respecting the
monuments.
The monuments, they don't even know.
It starts from schools, actually. As you said, that in Paris or in London or in any country, they teach them our history. Because this is the base of humanity, and this is the base of the humankind. Because we have one of the oldest civilization existed on Earth. That's why we say that Egypt is the gift of the Nile. And when we say Egypt is the gift of the Nile, this means that we have natural heritage, that we inherit the Nile from our ancestors. So we have to respect the Nile. The Egyptian deserts, this is also our heritage. We were talking about the oases and about the desert and everything, and the forests, Sinai. The Valley of the Whales. We have six main locations here in Egypt are listed among the world heritage sites. But it's a pity, because in Italy you will see 51 sites. And here in Egypt we have only six or seven sites. So we need to raise the awareness of those sites. We need to respect our monuments, because once we respect our monuments, the others will respect us, and they will respect our monuments. So again, it comes from schools, it comes from universities, and actually there is something very strange, because now or today all the sites are open for public for free and for students, but the students are still at their schools learning their lessons. So we need to arrange field trips to the museums and to
Usually we used to do that when we were at school, but it's not the case, I believe, anymore, because most of the schools do not make field trips to as a part of the curriculum as well, in order to make live visits to create more bonds between what the students do study and to see
these field trips could achieve both targets, learning and
fun.
They can have like a treasure
fun
hunt, and they can have games inside the museum or at the pyramids area, and they can learn something about it. But we need to arrange such a trip for all the students of Egypt.
They have to be interested.
Sometimes
the students themselves, they are not interested in that.
Yes, because
They find it boring.
They find it boring because actually it's not about the history teacher or the teacher who teaches them history. So he has to give them the history information in a very interesting way. Because I remember that I studied history, but I didn't have history during my high school. Because I knew that it was boring. But I loved history very much, and that's why I insisted to study history.
The way it was taught was boring.
The way, because look at the book, actually.
So here that would bring me to ask a very important question. How can we start to teach or to make the students interested in studying history? Because we have to...
You see, I believe
movies,
we need to revise so many things.
Movies,
I mean, we have
movies,
to look at things
movies,
from over.
Novels, field trips, to have a play, a big play at school to represent them, the history. Because actually in Egypt we have the oldest and the biggest history.
Allow me to add to this that we need even to revise how teachers are chosen in the first place.
Yes, now actually I remember in the last time I said that we need to hire the right places in
the right person for the right place. Indeed.
So that's why it's very important for us
at the very beginning, it's a complicated process.
To choose the person. Actually, the teacher is very important. And again, the International Day for Monuments and Sites, it has not to be a one day. This should
and
be like every
to know,
month.
To know much about it.
We need to celebrate about Luxor. We need to celebrate about Alexandria. We need to celebrate about the Valley of the Whales. Mm. And every year there is a theme. So what's the theme of this year? Do you know?
No.
The theme is sports, the heritage of sports. And here in Egypt, we have the oldest civilization,
indeed,
and we have the ancient Egyptian civilization, and you can see the scenes of
hunting,
them wrestling, hunting, playing, dancing,
exactly,
with the bowls and all of that. So we have the chess, or we have the Senate games, and it goes back to 2600 BC. So when they say that the theme of this year is sports, we have the oldest sports all over the world. Not the Olympics, but we had the sports here before the Olympics. So again, it needs awareness, and the main idea behind this day that to raise the awareness of the historical sites and places. And I'm glad that here in Egypt we celebrate this every year. However, we need to shed more lights on this festival, and I'm 100% sure that the Ministry of Antiquities this year are paying great attention, because they will have big celebrations in Pompey's Pillar in Alexandria for 3 days, and they will bring the students to visit the place, and also some places here in Cairo. So that's why they are trying.
I believe the media needs to highlight more this issue, because...
For example, in Saudi Arabia, this year they are celebrating the International Day of Monuments, or the World Heritage Day, for the fourth time.
In Saudi Arabia?
So, in Saudi Arabia. And actually, we need to learn something from our friends in the Gulf countries, because they started to cling to their culture. So if you go to the museums in the Gulf countries, in Saudi Arabia and Bahrain and the Emirates and even in Qatar, you will see that they started to create their own history. They want to cling to the history. Now they start like museums for the costumes and the dresses, for the boats, for pearl fishing and everything. We have an amazing museum here in Egypt, in Duki, the Wax Museum.
Yes.
If you go there, you will see actually all the culture of Egypt throughout the history. You will see them since the time of the pharaohs, you will see the time of the Mamluks, you will see even the modern times, you will see the farmers, you will see the dresses, you will see all the tools and the equipment. So actually the museums are very important, because this is the lighthouse of Egypt.
Actually, I've been to the Museum of Civilization as well in Fustat.
It's beautiful.
It hasn't been inaugurated officially yet, but it's beautiful because they have like new ideas. I mean, they have the labs, for example. And in those labs, the visitors get to see how the DNA of monuments is being, you know, like tested and the scientific process of everything. It's not just seeing a mummy or seeing some, but there is also those labs, and the scientific approach to the whole thing is really new. And the location is really amazing, because it lies at the heart of old Cairo, and overlooking the lake, and it's really huge. And I believe that we need to appreciate more, as Mahisi mentioned, we need to appreciate the idea of visiting museum, the idea of going to...
This has to be in our culture, to visit.
It has to be
things
integrated within our culture,
and
because, you know, in the mid-year vacation, for example, we go to Luxor and Aswan because there are cheap packages.
Yes.
Just like that.
But
and I've been there by chance. I've been there like last November and in January, and it was during the mid-year vacation. And when I went there, I found so many Egyptian families, like they were tired, and I was there, yes, I was attending the Luxor Film Festival, and now I remember,
yes.
I was attending the Luxor Film Festival, and by chance, it was the media vacation, there were many Egyptian families there, and they were like complaining, what am I seeing here, did I just come
stones.
To see some rocks and stones?
It's pathetic.
It's pathetic.
It is, and we need to teach our students this. And there is something, and actually we have a crisis now that we don't have tourism. So we can use the tour guides of Egypt. We have like 14,000 tour guides. Those tour guides can visit schools to raise the awareness of our students about their history.
And to make them more interested to go and
because
see.
Because
the
tour guides, have this skill to entertain or to give them the information.
Talk to
the
audience in an enthusiastic way.
Exactly. So they can bring history to life. This
Indeed.
Is the most important issue, because history is very like solid, but if you bring it to life, so
to
it
be
would
more
be very
interesting
for
like
even
storytelling
the
or
like storytelling.
Watching
it's very
a movie.
Important.
Because sometimes
and you can let them visit the museums at night. You can make like adventures for
when
them.
When you see it in movies
so
and dramas as well.
Idea.
Yeah.
In movies and dramas, if a movie like Cleopatra, so everyone is aware about the history of Cleopatra.
We need the movies and games, as I told you before. We need to have this theme. We need to have the Egyptian day in all our schools. So they have to be dressed like the Egyptians. To be dressed like the Egyptians, not only the pharaohs. The pharaohs, the Coptics, the Bedouins, the Farmers, the Mamluks, the Ottomans, because in Egypt we have a very long history.
Exactly.
We have the history goes back to 3100 BC and after the pharaonic
and
history,
it's
you
a,
have
it's
the
a mixture
history.
Or
it's
melange
a
of so many
this
cultures.
Is the, this is the beauty of Egypt. And we have something is called the CCTS, or the double CTS, culture, conservation, tourism, and sustainability. So you need to start with the culture, and we have culture because we have one of the oldest civilizations.
Indeed.
But once you have the culture, you need conservation because you need to keep it, you need to protect it. And after this, you will get the tourism because the tourists like to go to clean places, preserved places, they come for luxury. And then you need the sustainability because you need to keep it like ongoing process or an ongoing process.
Yes.
So that's why, again, we need to merge ministries together, like education. Not to merge, I mean together. I want to say
together.
That work together.
Collaboration.
To
between,
collaborate together. That education, higher education, antiquities, tourism, because we need to teach our students how to deal with the tourists.
Yes.
Because they come with different cultures. So this is, again, we need to respect the other's cultures because we don't choose our color, we don't choose our religion, we don't choose our cultures. And also the others didn't choose their cultures nor their religion. So we need to teach ourselves and to teach our students how to respect the other.
Yes. And we need to add our voices to yours. We need more than just one day to celebrate World Heritage Day.
Yes.
It should go on and several days around the year, especially that here in Egypt, for example, we have various museums. It's not only monuments.
Yeah.
We have, as you mentioned, the Wax Museum, we have the Coptic Museum, we have the Islamic
Nubian
Museum, we have the
amazing.
Nubian Museum.
The Nazwan.
We, yes, I mean, we have...
And the Nubian Museum is an ethnographic museum because it deals not only with the monuments, but it deals with the culture. It deals with the costumes,
we need to focus more on that, and
to have more... ethnographic museums in Egypt, not only monuments.
We hope to see that one day, but for now, I'd like to thank you very much, Dr. Mohamed Nabil, Professor of Egyptology. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we come to the end of this edition of The Breakfast Show. Today, you were in the company of Mr. Rabia and myself, Hanan Hamlawi. Goodbye for now.